Greetings. My name is Christina Hernandez Guerrero, and I oversee the public and campus programs at the USC Pacific Asia Museum in Pasadena, California. I'd like to thank all of you for joining us for this timely and needed conversation. Stronger Together, Black Liberation, and Asian Solidarity marks the first time that USC Pacific Asia Museum, the Chinese American Museum, and the Japanese National Museum come together in collaboration. Before we begin our program, we would like to pause for a moment of silence to acknowledge that Pam, Cam, and Janum were built on the ancestral and sacred lands of the Tongva Nation. During this moment of silence, we remember and honor the Tongva and all Indigenous people. Please take a moment to honor these ancestral grounds and celebrate the resilience and the strength that all Indigenous people show worldwide. Now you will hear a few words from our collaborating museums. Please help me in welcoming Bethany Montagano, the director of the USC Pacific Asia Museum.
Thank you so much, Christina, and thank you to our panelists and also to our USC partners on here as well. The USC Asia Pacific American Student Services and the Center for Black Cultural and Student Affairs at USC is joining us. And as Christina said, my name is Bethany Montagano. I am the director at the USC Pacific Asia Museum. I've been at the museum for a little bit over a year. And before this, I helped open the National Museum of the American Indian, and then after that, the National Museum of African American History and Culture. So I've never known a museum to be neutral, and it's in my blood, and I'm really excited to embark on this historic moment, really, with Janum and Cam, and also working with Melina as well, in order to kind of bridge divides and to make sure that we can make ourselves bigger by working together. And I have to say, in all honesty, in the wake of an election season built on fractures, really centuries in the making, I really believe that across every divide of party and age and race and class and geography, the vast majority of us sitting here today are here because we don't want to live this way anymore. To move forward, we must look back together, stories of wisdom and solidarity to help us really take up this existential societal challenge of moving beyond destabilizing and dehumanizing division. So this really entails facing our history, facing ourselves, and really facing each other. And I hope this will be one of many, many more conversations that we'll have together. And now I have the privilege of introducing Dr. Gay Huen. She is the president of the Friends of the Chinese American Board and is speaking on behalf of the Chinese American Museum.
Thank you, Bethany. And on behalf of the board of directors of the Friends of the Chinese American Museum, I want to send you the board's greetings also. We're delighted to be included, and we have to give thanks to Bethany and your group too for including us. We've collaborated several times with Janum because they're our sister museum. But so it's really great to be part of this triad that we're here today. For those of you who don't know where the Chinese American Museum is, we're located in El Pueblo Historical Monument. And so the question naturally would be, well, what's the Chinese American Museum doing in a Latino historical monument? And few people know that where the museum is located was actually where the original Chinatown was. And the Chinese were forced out almost overnight in the 30s when it was decided that Union Station will be built. And so once again, Chinese Americans were dispersed and shoved out. Fortunately, the city had a conscience. And so 20 some years ago, they decided to allow the Chinese American Museum founders to go to the community and to establish the museum there. And just as Anne was saying a while ago, we were established to tell the stories of the history of the Chinese in America. Where the museum is located right now is the place of the biggest Chinese massacre in 1871. And it was the biggest single ethnic group massacre west of the Mississippi. And that's history that's not taught. You know, I was a K-12 teacher before being a teacher educator, and nobody talks about that history. Our histories are told by those in power, and we need to change that, especially now. So I want to thank thank all of you for including us tonight. And it's my pleasure now to introduce my colleague, the president and CEO of the Japanese American Museum, National Museum, and that's Anne Burroughs.
Thank you, Gay. It feels like such a privilege to be partnering with the Pacific Asia Museum and the Chinese American Museum. It really is it's a historic collaboration. It's the first time that we're doing it. It's the first time that these three extraordinary sister museums in our city are coming together. And I think it's no accident that we are, and it's no accident that we're coming together to present this panel to you this evening, which I know will be extraordinarily moving, and I know that it'll challenge us and it'll inspire us. And if it doesn't do that, then it won't have achieved its aims. So, you know, certainly for us at JANM, you know, it's as Gay mentioned, you know, we're also built out of an extraordinary history, and we're also built on a place which has enormous importance for the history of Los Angeles, for the history of Japanese Americans, but also for the history of civil rights in Los Angeles. I mean, in just not Los Angeles, but in the country. We're built on the site where many of the Japanese Americans from Los Angeles were forced to gather to board buses that took them to incarceration during the Second World War. So, you know, the vision of JANM's founders is that, you know, it's not just to preserve that history and to ensure that that history is never forgotten, but it's also really to ensure that the same thing never happens to any other group, and that no other group is targeted in the same way or forced to endure what Japanese Americans were forced to endure during the Second World War. So, you know, fast forward from our founders, you know, where we are today is that we have a very, very deep commitment to preserving civil rights, to preserving the rights that are enshrined in the Constitution, to preserving democracy, and particularly those aspects of democracy that will allow us to amplify those lessons of history. Because we know that in order to be able to work towards a future that's based on social justice, and a future where there is a vibrant culture of democracy, we can't ever lose sight of that history, and we have to be able to use that history to shine a light on the present and to shape the future. So, you know, this panel, our program today really could not be more important, you know, not just because it's gathering all of us together, but also because it's gathering all of our panelists, our extraordinary panelists together, and all of us who've joined to actually think about, you know, the importance of this moment that we find ourselves in. And the topic could not be more important or consequential at this time of enormous racial reckoning in this country, and this historic moment in the movement of Black lives, and certainly for all of us, you know, this acknowledgement that of the centrality and the importance of cross-movement solidarity. So I know that our panel will inspire, it will challenge, and it'll motivate us. And, you know, it's a real honor for me to be able to introduce our moderator, who will hold it all together and take us to where we need to go. So, you know, Dr. Sandra Sohee-Chee Kim is the founder and co-executive director of the Asian American Justice and Innovation Lab, which is a community racial justice incubator that's committed to education and community building for promoting justice, radical love, and emergence. She's also an adjunct professor of race and ethnic studies at Cal State LA and a visiting scholar in USC's Department of American Studies and Ethnicity. Her research explores a range of topics, the intersections of race, global coloniality, migration, and culture. She's published widely, and she's currently working on the manuscript of a book entitled The Kinship of Empires, Trans-Pacific Coloniality, and Korean Historical Trauma. So Sandra, welcome, and it's over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that introduction, Anne. I'm so honored to be here to facilitate this intergenerational conversation among three movement leaders I personally deeply admire. The wealth of history, wisdom, vision, and experience that these three individuals cumulatively bring to the table is quite extraordinary. And I personally can't wait to hear what they have to say. I'm sure you feel the same. For our audience members, feel free to drop a question in the Q&A box located at the bottom of your screen at any point during tonight's program, and we will get to them as time allows during the Q&A portion. So I'm going to start off by introducing each panelist, followed by a tailored question before then moving on to introduce the next panelist. And I'm going to start with Dr. Melina Abdullah. Dr. Melina Abdullah is a recognized expert on race, gender, class, and social movements. She was among the original group of organizers that convened to form Black Lives Matter, which everyone here knows of today because it is the largest movement in history. And she continues to serve as a Los Angeles chapter leader. She's also a professor and former chair of Pan-African Studies at Cal State LA. Dr. Abdullah is the author of numerous articles and book chapters with subjects ranging from coalition building to womanist mothering. And she has contributed to popular media outlets, including The Root, Los Angeles Times, Truth Dig, Los Angeles Sentinel, Los Angeles Progressive, and BK Nation. She's also the co-host and co-producer of the weekly radio program Beautiful Struggle, which airs on KPFK, and the host and producer of the weekly internet radio show Move the Crowd, which airs on Radio Justice. Check those out. Dr. Abdullah is also the recipient of many awards, among them the 2018 Community Service Award from the National Council for Black Studies, the 2017 Unsung Heroes Award from the Oscar Grant Foundation, and the 2017 Extraordinary Service Award from the African Heritage Studies Association. I could go on, but I will jump into my first question, which is for you, Melina. As I said earlier, you are a leader in what is now considered the largest movement in history. And central among the issues that Black Lives Matter has been addressing is the demand to defund the police. And there are so many misunderstandings circulating out there about what defunding the police actually means. So could you please explain for us the abolitionist vision driving Black Lives Matter initiatives and what it has to do with the vision of a just and liberated world?
My kids would be proud. I remembered to unmute before talking. So
wonderful.
So thank you so much for having me. It's great to be with you. So I just shared with Sandra before we started that we have a mutual bestie, and Dr. Molly Talcott, who's one of our dear friends. I'm grateful to be with Warren Furutani. Doesn't know me, but I know him. Followed his work for a long time and grateful for the support that he's provided to our union, right? Was a great friend to California Faculty Association when he was in the legislature. So I've been to your office several times when you were in Sacramento. So it's grateful. I'm grateful to be here with you. And then Gay is one of, she embodies this so much. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about solidarity and being stronger together, Gay and I did just, I think, beautiful work at Cal State LA. And really, you know, you never have an understanding like just doing the work, right? And so the work that we had to do to make the campus stronger for Black students, to maintain Asian American Studies, which is now a department, thanks to the vision of Asian American faculty and students in partnership. We won that. That was a Black and Asian effort together, and we won that together. And so I'm grateful to be here. My heart is dancing seeing your face after, you know, it's been a couple of years since I've seen you, so I'm grateful. And everybody, right? So just to get to your question, Sandra, about what we mean by defund the police. I know that there's many who are in office, many who are kind of in mainstream politics who are pushing back against defund the police. They don't think it's, you know, what we should be saying. At the same time, they've won the Democratic Party, won because of Black Lives Matter, whose clarion call was defund the police. So I think you can't capitalize off an effort and then, you know, really push back against that same effort. I think that that's problematic. And so I'm going to say wholeheartedly, we absolutely still believe in defunding the police. And this is what it means. It means exactly what it says it means. Defunding the police means we want to take money away from an overinvestment in a system of policing that was deliberately and intentionally designed to put targets on the backs of Black people. Without argument, no person with any legitimacy can say that police did not come from slave catching. Policing in this country is absolutely a vestige of chattel slavery. So as ridiculous as it would be to say, no, let's just reform chattel slavery, that's the same ridiculousness with which we must greet people who say, let's reform the current system of policing. So defund the police began the first year into Black Lives Matter. We got a hold of the city budget right here in Los Angeles and saw that we were spending at that time upwards of 50% of the city's general fund on LAPD. Upwards of 50% went straight to LAPD. And then as we kind of unpacked the budget, we realized it was even more than that because all of these other departments had contracts with the police where they were giving parts of their share, Department of Transportation, Rec and Parks. Others were giving parts of their share also to LAPD. By 2019, we had seen budget proposals where it was up to 54% of the city's general fund going to police. And I just want to remind folks of the words of wisdom spoken by renowned economist Dr. Julianne Malvo, that a budget is a moral and ethical document, right? When you're and it's a zero-sum game. So when you're spending 54% of your money on police, you are not spending those dollars on after-school programs. When we think about the fact that we're in the worst pandemic, health pandemic of our lifetime, right? With an economic fallout that is unparalleled. Why are we spending money on LAPD? If we're spending money on LAPD, we're not spending money on PPE. We're not spending money on public health. That's dollars that we're not spending on the mental health of our people at a time when 50% of Black youth are thought to have seriously contemplated suicide. right? We're not spending those dollars on arts programs. We're not spending those dollars on creating good jobs. We're not spending those dollars on supporting Black-owned businesses, 50% of whom are estimated to projected to never come back after the pandemic. So when we say defund the police, we mean pull those dollars out of a policing system that kills Black people, that harasses Black people, that decimates Black community, and invest those dollars instead. So we always pair it with reimagined public safety, a reimagined view of public safety. We know that who creates safe communities is strong communities. And we know that we create safe communities when we invest in intervention work and prevention work and provide people with the basics of what they need. And so that's what's meant, and I could go on and on, so I'm sorry.
That's great.
That's what's meant when we say defund the police, and we're continuing to say it loud, whether, you know, the Democratic Party and, you know, of course, the Republican Party would never even repeat those words, right? Whether they think it's, you know, politically valuable or not. We know that it is, and we know that we've been saying it. And it was the clarion call at the time when masses of people decided to step into this work. So it also resonates with regular folks, even if it doesn't resonate with political parties.
Thank you. Thank you so much for opening us up with those thoughts, because it is a central concern in our historic moment now. I'd like to move on to introducing Warren T. Furutani. Warren has been a community activist for 50 years. In the late 60s, he worked to establish Asian American studies at UCLA and Cal State Long Beach and admissions programs for underrepresented students. And he was one of the founders of the Manzanar Pilgrimage Committee and worked in the APIA community and other communities of color around a multitude of civil rights and social justice issues. He was also the first APIA person elected to the Los Angeles Unified School District Board of Education, two terms actually for 8 years, the second APIA to be elected to the LA Community College District Board of Trustees, where he served for 3 terms, a total of 10 years, and served in the State Assembly for 3 terms, where he chaired the APIA Legislative Caucus for 3 years. He retired from the legislature in November 2012 and has since served as a commissioner on the Los Angeles City Board of Public Works. Currently, he is a senior fellow at UCLA's Luskin School of Public Affairs and an education and government relations consultant. Warren, welcome. My question for you is, you have been deeply involved in the Asian American movement, starting in its early stages in the 1960s, as well as a number of other social justice movements over the course of your lifetime. And we really regard you as a movement elder in this room. Like Dr. Melina was saying, you know, she knows who you are. We do, because you have this very long history of being involved in multiple social movements. Would you please speak to the Asian American movement's relationship to the Black-led civil rights movement at the time and Black power, and the evolutions you've witnessed leading into our present moment?
First of all, good evening, everybody. And it's an honor and a pleasure to be here. I'm particularly excited, and I've crossed paths with Melina, but I'm particularly excited and honored because I'm sort of bookend by somebody that has changed the not only course of history and dialogue relative to social justice, but on the other bookend with Kai Williams, as it turns out, I have been on social justice panels with her great-grandmother, Yuri Kochiyama. So we have generations, and I get it, Sandra. I get that I'm the multi-generational person here, and that's my role on the panel, but it's an honor to be here. You know, the way I came up in the late 60s, mid to late 60s, after graduating from Guardian High School in 1965, it seemed everything was in the context of third world people. I went to the Bay Area to join a program at the College of San Mateo. It was called the College Readiness Program, run by a gentleman named Bob Hoover. And the whole concept was to take non-traditional college students, Chinese kids from Chinatown, San Francisco, African-Americans from East Palo Alto, Ravenswood High School, Latinos from the Mission District and different areas. We had American Indians from the local reservation. We had working class white kids in our program. But it was all about third world, and even the San Francisco State strike, the Cal Berkeley strike at the time, it was all the third world liberation front. So the context was always people of color, third world. Everybody had their lane, but everybody was driving in the same direction. And I think one of the things that comes out of this most recent election is anybody assuming that any group, any ethnic group, any racial group, any gender group, were a monolithic group that can be easily categorized or put into one cubbyhole just doesn't understand the new America. And that's the challenge, I think, is redefining, as Melina said, reimagining, not only in terms of issues of criminal justice, law enforcement, social justice, but the issue of who makes up America. I mean, looking at what happened in the election, if President Biden, President-elect Biden doesn't realize that his victory is owed to first South Carolina, when the African-American vote changed the whole Democratic primary. He was dead in the water until they came out and changed the whole course of the primary. And then in the last days of the election, everybody was waiting for the last count. But where was the count coming from? It was coming from Atlanta, Georgia. It was coming from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. It was coming from Milwaukee. It was coming from Detroit, Michigan, where there's a stronghold of African-American votes, where they came out, everybody came out. And as sure as we can boast how many people voted, 80 million people voted for President Biden, we got to remember that the second most votes ever cast for a presidential candidate was for President Trump. So we have a lot of work to do. But what people need to remember is that the Asian American community, Asian Pacific Islander American community, is connected at the hip with the civil rights movement, with the Civil Rights Act in 64 and then the Voting Rights Act in 65. It was coupled with the Immigration Act of 1965, which totally changed immigration patterns, which up until then had really favored Europeans from Northern and Western Europe and opened the door for people from Asia and other parts of the world to immigrate. And that totally changed Asian Americans. But in my growing up, my father's born here, my grandfather's born in Hawaii, my granddaughter is sixth generation Japanese American, but still people look at me and sometimes I feel like I'm a forever foreigner. And obvious of that is the anti-hate that's come about with the coronavirus, where people look at you and assume just based upon our looks. And when we're all wearing masks, the most identifiable physical characteristic, if you're wearing a mask, is your eyes. And when they look at their eyes and people, like the president says, it's the China virus, then people's anti-Asian hate, this forever foreigner attitude, this view that we are outsiders, no matter how many generations we've been here. But I grew up a time when everybody looked around, people of color, we all sort of gave the nod and the wink. You know, if you are African-American, Latino, Asian, if you happen to know Native Americans, people knew that if someone came up to you and whispered in your ear and said, you know, I like you Asians, but I don't like the Mexicans, you know they were going up to the Latinos and saying, I like you Mexicans, but I don't like them damn Asians. We knew we were in the same boat. But now with immigration, a lot of Asian immigrants have come to this country after the civil rights movement. So they don't understand, and that's why they didn't come out the way they would have come out for Prop 16, because they don't get it yet.
Yeah.
They don't realize this is not a meritocracy, this is a democracy. And what we're talking about is not raising just your vote, we're about raising all votes. And so as a democracy, and as what the BLM has done, BLM has changed the course of not only the discussion, but the course of history. Just like a lot of things we've done with the civil rights movement, Manzanar pilgrimage to a much lesser degree, other examples, whether it was in the fields of California with Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta, these are all a part of American history. So that's where I think ultimately we look at this. What the BLM has done is really changed the dialogue, is really put forth front and center. And I came up with during a time when John Carlos and Tommy Smith raised their black glove fist at the Olympics, just like Colin Kaepernick kneeled at a football game. Changed the course of the discussion. And so this is what we have to do relative to, in my opinion, is continue the discussion based upon who really makes up America today and now.
Thank you so much for that, Warren. I think that that highlights just the importance of centering Black liberation. It's what fed into greater civil rights for Asian Americans too. And I think that's the pattern that we see, is that centering Black liberation is good for all of us. Next, I'd like to introduce Kai Naima Williams. Thank you for coming here. She is a storyteller, poet, and performer based in New York City. Her current work intersects her interests in pop culture and magical practice with her academic background in creative writing and Black studies. She is the co-founder and executive director of Eat at the Table Theater Company, a nonprofit arts organization dedicated to providing young actors of color with performance opportunities. And as Warren mentioned, she is the great-granddaughter of the civil rights revolutionary Yuri Kochiyama. Kai is the author of the chapbook, He Tried to Drown the Ocean, I Waved, and her writing has been featured in Mask Magazine, Drone Magazine, Louisiana Literature, Stirring Lit, and Crown Magazine. And she has been honored by the Tennessee Williams Literary Festival, the National Young Arts Foundation, and the New York Times. Welcome, Kai. My question for you is, how do you see the role of the imagination in our movements for social justice?
Thank you, Sandra, for that question. And to everyone for having me. I'm really honored to be speaking here amongst Warren and Melina. So thank you so much for that. I would say that from my perspective, imagination plays one of the most crucial roles in social justice and liberation efforts, because it is our tool for transforming any desire for freedom from a fantasy to being a reality. I think if I was to give a very, very simplistic understanding of how social change, or you might say revolution, occurs, it would be divided into two steps. So the first would be to implode systems of oppression and colonialism that historically and currently function. And then the second step would be to replace those structures with alternative modes of being in community with one another that are created with the imperative of freedom in mind. So in my perspective, imagination is kind of the precursor to both of these actions, to both dismantling present structures and developing future ones, because we have to be able to imagine that current systems of oppression, no matter how ingrained in our societies they may be, are able to be deconstructed. And that's something we're taught is an impossibility. So first we have to imagine the possibility of that. And then we have to be able to imagine what their alternatives are. So for me, imagination is really the cornerstone of any work to create or generate or cultivate liberation. And there's a Toni Morrison quote that goes, imagination fosters real possibilities. If you can't imagine it, you can't have it. And I think that's really true in the context of social justice movements, because the goal of these movements isn't just to dismantle what harms people, right? It's also about envisioning what empowers them. It's not just about recognizing what is wrong with our societies, but it's also about deciding what would make them better and more equitable and more pleasurable and more just, and how we make that happen. So that envisioning begins with people's desires for something different than what they experience. I think that the act of imagining something beyond your reality or other than your reality is sort of inherently radical, because even in its most basic state, you know, even before an idea is vocalized or enacted in any way, in imagining something new, you decline to accept your reality as is. Imagination sort of pushes back against a perceived immutability of our experiences. And I know that I'm using this generic pronoun we and are quite liberally here. And I think it's important to note that freedom looks different for different communities.
Yeah.
But I think that this application of imagination can be shared by pretty much anyone who is committed to liberation efforts.
Thank you, Kai. That was a beautiful answer. My next questions will be for all of you. And I'd like to start off with, what is your favorite historic example of Black and Asian solidarity? And what can we learn from it for the challenges that we face today? I think I'd like to start with Warren, if that's okay.
Well, you know, there's many we can cite where people have stood arm in arm, but let me share a personal one. I heard Stokely Carmichael speak in South Park and Watts way back in the day. And Stokely said, the most important thing for Black people to do was to define themselves for themselves and by themselves. And even though I could dance and do the Temptation Walk and I listened to Smokey Robinson, and I didn't think he was talking to me. But then I had this epiphany. And the epiphany was, if I just took out Black and put in the term of the day, Oriental, it told me the same thing. If I wanted to empower myself and not live up to the stereotypes and assumptions and prejudices people had about myself as an Oriental at the time, I needed to redefine myself. Mm. And just like at the clarion call that Melina's talking about in terms of Black Lives Matter, the clarion call for Black power by Stokely and Rapp and so many others became the clarion call for people power. And it's all interconnected. There's examples of people standing arm in arm and fighting together, battling, winning, losing, getting up from a loss and winning again. But when you look at it, everybody's liberation is interdependent with the other people. We can't liberate one group without liberating the other.
Yeah.
And that's why the challenge is systemic.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just an individual, it's systemic, it's in the system. So as Kai talks about being able to imagine what social justice looks like, we have to be able to characterize, visualize, explain what the hell this is that we're fighting for and fighting about.
Yes, thank you. What a beautiful answer. Melina, could we go to you next? What is your favorite historic example of Black Asian solidarity, and what can we learn from it for the challenges we face today?
Yeah, I thought the example that Warren gave was great, and I think it kind of ties in with my example. So I teach in Pan-African studies, and when we think about what birthed ethnic studies, it was solidarity across people of color, and also with the support of radical white folks as well, right? So, you know, we just finished reading, the first read of my Black Power class, of course, is Kwame Ture. So as you talk about Stokely Carmichael, we're reading him, and grateful to be doing that. But, and I think that the example of the birth of ethnic studies in 1968, beginning with Black students on the front lines at San Francisco State, but also supported by community, by radical faculty, and recognizing that the set of disciplines that they were seeking to birth was radically different than any other discipline that was housed in a university, because it would be the first set of disciplines that found its home in the struggle that began in community. Right? So ethnic studies, Black studies, Chicana Latina studies, Asian, Asian American studies, and Indigenous studies has an allegiance to liberation struggle. And so it was Black folks from the Black Panther Party. It was Chicano folks, and I'm really, you know, blessed to be in community still with people like Carlos Montes and the Brown Berets, you know, who struggled for ethnic studies. It was Asian American folks who have been given this false designation of model minorities, yes, when they were aligned with Black folk, radical Black folks, radical Latino, Chicano folks, in birthing ethnic studies. So there's this historic victory from 1968, which forms our disciplines, right? And then it also leads us up to this moment. And so I think that there's a challenge. Warren talked about Prop 16. You know, I think that there's both a missed opportunity in that we couldn't get to everyone quickly enough, but also I think that there was an awakening, right? There was a refusal, you know, some of my best friends and colleagues were very instrumental in saying that Asian American folks have to understand that affirmative, there's something in it for us when, yeah, we talk about affirmative action. And so, you know, I'm grateful that they kind of reached back to that solidarity that was developed in 1968. So people like Janelle Wong and others who were willing to push forward and speak specifically and explicitly about the need to recapture, mm-hmm, a kind of radical understanding of what freedom means and how our plights are all bound up together. And we're seeing that same thing happen with the passage of AB 1460, which is the ethnic studies requirement in the CSU. And now we're gonna push for an implementation plan that is upholds authentic ethnic studies. So I think that there's the historic examples and they inform our contemporary ones as well.
Thank you, I love that example. And I've been very involved in all of the rallying and protesting around the College of Ethnic Studies at Cal State LA and who should be the dean. It should be Melina, by the way, everybody. And yeah, that was a situation where they were avoiding putting into place the inaugural dean as somebody who is like Melina, who's been fighting for ethnic studies in our state for a very long time and really pushed for the College of Ethnic Studies to be birthed, which is the second College of Ethnic Studies in the country after the San Francisco State University College of Ethnic Studies that both Warren and Melina have referred to, which were a result of student protests in 1968. And so who did they appoint? They tried to appoint an Asian American person who is, you know, I'm sure a wonderful person, a wonderful leader, but this, there's so many ways in which Asian Americans are by white supremacy positioned as a racial wedge. And I think we all need to be cognizant of that because as both Warren and Melina have been saying, our liberation is bound up with one another. Kai, I would love to hear your favorite historic example of Black and Asian solidarity.
Sure. Well, you know, I think when I think about Black and Asian solidarity, my mind automatically goes to the example of my family, the personal example of my family, specifically my great-grandmother, Yuri Kochiyama, who was a revolutionary civil rights activist and anti-imperialist. And when I say a revolutionary, I mean as a noun instead of an adjective, someone who was literally committed to the concept of revolution and the work of revolution. And for me, Yuri embodies solidarity in many ways, but I'll try to distill it down to an example or two. So Yuri was awakened to the concept of systemic racism through her experience in Japanese American concentration camps. She wasn't politicized there, she wasn't radicalized there, but she was awakened to the experience of systemic racism. And that was after a lifetime of having considered herself an American patriot. And then she moved to Harlem with her husband Bill and her six children. And she and Bill immediately involved themselves in the Harlem Parents Committee and in the Harlem Freedom School, because they felt that if they were going to live in a predominantly Black neighborhood, that it was important that they involve themselves in and become knowledgeable about the community. And it was there in Harlem that she began to become involved in the civil rights movement and began to educate herself and really, you know, about by listening to and learning from members of the community, and really start to understand the United States as an imperialist, white supremacist nation state. And then thereafter dedicated her entire life to joining in their struggle, joining in that struggle collectively. And so that progression signals solidarity to me, that she learned about systemic racism through her own experience and then made it really the point of her life to learn about how it disproportionately affected other groups and joined those struggles as a sister and as a comrade to others in many movements. And then not, you know, she also embodied solidarity by dedicating herself to mutual aid, not just in work, but really in every element of her life and her relation to others. So, you know, it wasn't that she went to work as an activist and compartmentalized that and came home and had time off. Her home itself was a safe haven and a community space for anyone who needed it. People used to call her apartment on 126th Street Grand Central Station, because so many movement people passed through it and spent time there. And I think it was Mutulu Shakur, who's a great friend of hers, that said she was known as the person that you called when you got out of prison, because she would always have a bed or food for you. And I think, you know, we talk a lot about redistributing wealth as something very basic that allies can do. And Yuri didn't, you know, have financial wealth to redistribute, but she shared all of her basic resources, food and shelter, but also love and care. And I think that that's something we can learn from her example, is that she approached the struggle with care for others, with an emphasis on empathy and communication. And I think, personally, I think that that is something that isn't always valued enough, especially when there's division amongst communities, that solidarity can extend beyond work into home and into family. You know, I am a Japanese and Black person, and in a lot of ways I see myself as a living product of Yuri's capacity to bring people together in pursuit of Black liberation. So my grandparents, my grandmother is her daughter, Audie, and my grandfather, Terry, who was a Black man from Mississippi, they met while they were organizing for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So that impact of Yuri's work towards solidarity actually engendered intersectionality in me and my father, my aunt, my cousins, my brother. My family is full of Black and Asian people. I know this is quite a long-winded answer, but I think there are lessons to be learned about care, about intersections of love and home with work and with struggle that we can benefit from.
Oh, what a beautiful snapshot of Yuri Kochiyama. Thank you so much for sharing that. I'm going to move on to the next question, which is again for all of you, and it has to do with the immediate aftermath of the November 3rd election day, where we're in a situation where communities of color flipped 5 states for Joe Biden, and we have a sitting president who refuses to concede defeat. And here in Los Angeles specifically, we had some really historic victories on measures fighting abuses of the criminal justice system, investing in our communities, and providing alternatives to incarceration. And then meanwhile, the COVID-19 pandemic rages on, with the rate of infection climbing by the day. And Gay was just informing us before this meeting started that lockdown and curfew is starting again here in Los Angeles, starting on Saturday. News brief. So where do we go from here is really my question. And Melina, I would love to start with you.
I think where we go is demanding something for our vote. So at the federal level, we need to make sure that, I want to be clear that the folks who voted out the Trump regime were absolutely mobilized and motivated by a really deep need to vote him out. Yeah. This was not a statement of support for the Biden-Harris administration. It was a calculation, a political calculation, and an understanding that Trump had to go, right? So what that means is that Biden-Harris still has to earn our support. And they owe their administration specifically to Black people and Black organizers in particular, right? So when we think about people like Stacey Abrams, yes, registering 600,000 people to vote in Georgia, flipping states like Georgia and Michigan, and, you know, Black people in Philly coming out like that, right? That there is something, a debt to be paid to, mm-hmm, Black voters, to Black organizers, to Black women. And I think way too often that's taken for granted, and we have to refuse to take that for granted now. Are to be taken for granted. Now, that doesn't mean that the threat is now we're going to run to a party that is deeply steeped in obviously and violent white supremacy, right? But there are other options, and I'm thinking about, you know, as we draw inspiration from history, I'm thinking about Fannie Lou Hamer and the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party. I'm thinking about what's happening with the Workers' Family Party, right? And the opportunity to kind of rethink two-party systems that too often are owned by corporate interests and white supremacist capitalism. What we see at the local level is an unwillingness to really kind of fall in line with what either of the two major parties tell us we have to do. So in Los Angeles County, we passed Measure J, right, over the police money. So on one side, you got police and corporate money. On the other side, you have people power. So Measure J was conceptualized in literally the 11th hour. I remember getting a phone call saying, hey, what do you think about this? And Kendrick Sampson of Bill Power and I were on the phone with this guy who had come up with this idea and was working in partnership with some other folks. And we were going, can we do that? Right? And apparently we can, because we did. And yeah, what voters in Los Angeles County decided is absolutely, we want to defund the police. We want to make sure that at least, you know, some allocation is committed to the things that actually make communities safe, right? So Measure J allocates 10% of the county's unrestricted funds to things like mental health care, things like housing, things like good jobs, and keeps those dollars away from jails and sheriffs, right? That's what the people voted for. The people also voted to oust the worst district attorney in Los Angeles County history, who's one of those skin folk who ain't kinfolk, right? So Jackie Lacey has overseen the murder of 628 people at the hands of police and refuses to prosecute police who kill our folks. So it was important for the people again to organize themselves and oust this person who was backed to the tune of at least $7 million by police associations, right? And so we won that on the local level. I think that what that means is that everybody else from the federal level on down needs to start paying attention to what's happening on the ground. So they can say, you know, they can push back against, you know, our defund the police call. They can push back if they want to. But the people are demanding something that is more than kind of a tinkering around the edges. We're demanding something that's more than symbolic representation embodied through Kamala Harris. We're demanding a substantive change that really reorients this country and centers Black liberation as a prerequisite for the liberation of all of our people.
Yes, yes. I'm just like thinking, amen, amen. Preach, sister, you know? Thank you so much. I would love to hear from Warren now. Is Warren there? Do you have to unmute, Warren? There he is. Oh, I can't hear you. Warren? Warren's sound is not working. Kyle, why don't we hear from you first while we work on Warren's sound?
Sure. I would like to also say amen to a lot of the points that Melina brought up and, repeat and recognize the fact that this administration does owe a debt to grassroots organizers who have sort of just recently demonstrated the incredible impact and leverage and power that they had in impacting this political system, and that, you know, that is, they are indebted to Black people in cities that flip their states, especially Black women, the Navajo Nation in Arizona. So these are grassroots organizers amongst communities of color that have demonstrated this incredible impact and leverage. So I do think that there are efforts to be made to try and convince the Biden-Harris administration to pay off that debt, to respond to certain policies and agendas that can, you know, engender survival for vulnerable communities. Policies like passing the Green New Deal, relocations of funds to communities of color. You know, we may not achieve universal health care through this administration or in the next 4 years, but I think, you know, that is clearly a necessity for survival. But I think it's difficult to reconcile and grapple with the fact that in ousting the Trump regime, we have also just elected a man who co-authored the 1993 crime bill, who is a perpetrator of sexual violence, if we choose to believe the women who have come forward and accused him, and you know, Kamala Harris, who is the self-proclaimed top cop and who was instrumental in criminalizing sex work and criminalizing marijuana, and who is personally responsible for the incarceration of many. So I think that's a very difficult thing for us to reconcile while we fight for prison abolition and defunding of the police. So I think that in some ways, this moment reminds me that we need to be mindful of the fact that liberation doesn't necessarily come from participation in civic measures to sort of uphold American democracy and reform the US government. And I also think that the work and the goals of abolition don't necessarily change regardless of who the current president is. But also at the same time, acknowledging that trying to affect policies can enable survival and harm reduction for vulnerable communities, and also, you know, for the health of the planet. Yeah, that's what I would say.
Thank you, Kai. Warren, are you there? Is your sound working? Can you hear me, Warren? Okay, I think we'll move on to audience Q&A right now, since I think Warren is having some technical difficulties. So let me see if we have any questions. And please do drop your questions in the Q&A tool found at the bottom of your screen. But if the organizers could put in the chat box any questions that have come up, that would be great. That would help me a lot. I see a lot of wonderful comments here. Okay, we have a question for Dr. Abdullah. Your description of budget being a moral and ethical document at the state and city level with its police forces also feels applicable to the US military budget, who also target Black and Brown and other people of color youth for recruitment. How do we take on something as formidable as the US military? What are you telling your people who are standing up to armed police who've proven to be dangerous against civil disobedience and who hold immense power via violence? That's a great question.
It's also a really huge question, right? So I agree completely that the military budget is a parallel. It's absolutely one of the national federal parallels. There's been work done for many years. Costofwar.com is one of the places that we see them talking about the trade-off, how much we spend on war and how little we spend on education, how much this country spends on war and how little is spent on making sure that its people has the basics like housing and food, right? And so there's absolutely a parallel. And I think that we can do it all. I think a reimagined view of the world, a reimagined view of public safety really requires a revisioning of the world. And so I think we have to step back. One of the things that I often have my students do, but I also do with regularity, is I meditate every single day, but also every 6 months to a year, part of that meditation includes thinking about what vision or visioning the world in which I want to live, and then writing that vision down, right? So as we talk about abolition and the abolition of police, I saw another question in the chat about prisons. They absolutely go hand in hand. Also goes hand in hand with the abolition of militarism, right? And so, you know, in this moment, what does it mean to be visionary? I think about people like Barbara Lee, who visions a Department of Peace, right? What would a Department of Peace look like at the federal level? And there actually is opportunity. If Biden Harris were courageous, they would name Barbara Lee to the cabinet over a new Department of Peace that she visioned, right? So there's absolutely parallels. The second part of that question, and I'll try to be quicker about it, about standing in the face of police when we know that they're violent and we know that they steal the lives, especially of Black people, is Black Lives Matter is steeped in a tradition of what we call courageous discipline, right? And, you know, you can't seek to dismantle a system that steals the life and has stolen the lives of our people without some risk. And if you're engaging in work without risk, you're really not doing real work. There's gonna be repercussions. And you know, just speaking individually, some people know that just over the last couple of months, the district attorney's husband pointed a loaded gun at my chest and threatened to shoot me. Then just a few months after that, my house was swatted, surrounded by armed police with assault rifles, helicopters overhead, and pointed assault rifles in the window at me, right, while my three children were there. There's repercussions. You can't seek to topple a system, a violent system, and not expect that that system will descend upon you. It will. But, and this will be the last thing I say, I'm sorry about this, but we also have our own systems and structures. So when my house was surrounded by about 40 officers, right, with assault rifles, I couldn't see from my window. But as I walked out and I had my phone, I was live streaming it. As I walked out, I looked out and about a dozen of my neighbors were outside. And my neighbor from across the street met me. First, he said, "Why are you coming out?" And I said, "My children are inside. I have to pull them away from the house to protect my children." And he said, "Well, if you're going to walk towards them," because the instruction was for me to walk towards them with my hands up. And he put his body in front of mine. And he said to me, "If they shoot, you're not going to be the one to take the first bullet." So every time I tell that story, it's hard for me to not become emotional. And I won't apologize for it, but I will say what that reminds us is regardless of danger, we also have our own tools, and our tools are our community. We're not in the struggle by ourselves, and it binds us together in ways that we couldn't even imagine. Engaging in struggle collectively binds us together in ways that transcend even the word solidarity, you know? And so I just want to lift that up. There is danger, but we'll defeat it all as long as we're committed wholeheartedly and righteously and in a united way. I know that we'll win.
Oh my goodness. I moved to tears. Melina, thank you so much for sharing that. And it leads actually nicely into another question, which is, what are some ways we can mobilize more folks in the Asian and Black communities to support each other, especially in the reawakening of anti-Asian violence and the continuation of anti-Black violence? And since Warren is back on, let's ask you first, or not everyone has to answer every question, but I was wondering, Warren, if you'd like to address that one. He's connecting to audio. Oh, we're having some technical difficulties. Kai, would you be willing to answer that question?
Sure. Yeah, I definitely agree that this is a very difficult, these are difficult conversations to begin when there feels like there is divisiveness within community. And I'll say that as a young person who is like privy to especially internet organizing, there's a culture of division that I think has really permeated in-person interaction. I'll say that, you know, when I began attending college, when I was a freshman, there were multiple affinity and organizing groups, you know, across racial lines that would make it a point to collaborate with one another. And, you know, 4 years later, that those kinds of collaborations are almost virtually unheard of. I think there's a couple ways in which we can bridge those divisions and make sure both communities are in conversation. One is that we recognize that anti-Blackness and anti-Indigeneity is at the crux of all colonial power and systemic racism. So across the world, Black people, darker skinned people, that includes, you know, Asian people, South Asian groups, and Indigenous peoples are the most marginalized members of their societies. And especially in the United States, racism against any group of people is rooted in anti-Blackness. So I think someone had mentioned the, you know, the model minority myth, which hurts Asians and was created in order to sow division amongst Black people and Asian people, right? And reinforce that Black people remain the least privileged members of society. So I think it's important, it's essential, you know, that we acknowledge that in dismantling anti-Blackness, we dismantle the same forms of racism that impact non-Black groups as well. But I would also say that right now, I feel like there's a lot of emphasis on allyship. And I think that there are problems with the emphasis on allyship versus solidarity. To me, being an ally is an identity that is sort of grounded in being outside of an oppressed group. And it's a position of support that is not mutual. It's typically, an ally is typically a person of privilege whose focus is on supporting and helping members of an oppressed group. And that's not to say that allies shouldn't exist, or that everyone has to be a comrade instead of an ally. But I also think that, especially in these discussions and especially online, the way a person practices allyship tends to be utilized as a way to measure an individual's character and investment in marginalized people. So it's about the perception of an individual instead of being an actual struggle. But solidarity is coalitional. It's based in mutual support and in relation to one another. So instead of one group uplifting another, solidarity requires different people to recognize the interconnectedness of our experiences, and be in struggle alongside each other to work to dismantle these structures that are responsible for all of our oppressions, like anti-Blackness. And that doesn't have to signify that people who are in solidarity with one another share identical oppressions. You know, it doesn't mean that our experiences are equal, and there's still the imperative to center the most marginalized voices in any given space. But while we may not experience the same oppression or the same harm, we absolutely share common oppressors. And I think, you know, solidarity requires us to be accountable to one another and to listen to one another and to be willing to suspend judgment of one another. And I think a lot of that community division includes a judgment that is sort of cast even before these conversations begin, a judgment that is based on our understanding and assumptions about each other's cultural markers. So I think we have to really be willing to suspend judgment. We have to be willing to acknowledge the role that anti-Blackness plays in all of our oppressions, and to be able to, you know, really commit to listening and speaking to one another. And I think it's a very difficult thing, especially for young people to do. But in my mind, that's a step. That's a critical step.
Thank you, Kai. That was a very thorough answer and brilliant. So I think I will move on to the next question. And Warren seems to be back. Can we hear from you, Warren? Hello. Let's see if you say something, if we can hear you. Oh, no, I can't hear him. Oh, no. Okay. Well, I will move on to the next question, which is, how can Asian Americans support the movement behind Defund the Police when many in our community pushes back against this due to either privilege, anti-Black racism, or assimilation into white supremacy? What are the Asian American institutions actively doing for this cause? This would have been a great question for Warren. but if Melina or Kai want to weigh in on this, it would be great.
I think Kai is better equipped to respond to this one than me.
Yeah, I mean, I think this question is sort of similar to the one that preceded it. I think certainly a way that Asian American groups can support Black people is by trying to create and uplift platforms in which Black people talk about their experiences, and also asking the question of what do you need from us? Ask literally being in conversation and asking Black people and Black communities, how can we help? I think it's difficult and a misstep to only have these conversations amongst our own communities, without bridging the gap to actually be in conversation and I think also that those conversations can be intimidating. Again, I think that there are physical divisions and barriers to being in conversation that may be rooted in fear of how one is perceived or how a group is perceived. I think, again, there's a lot of online judgment that comes from, how you phrase something. I think there's a fear of sort of navigating jargon and language in a way that creates a barrier for people to begin to speak to one another. But I think that those conversations are really necessary just to sort of ask. And I think also, if you're able to put your body on the line, if there are physical protests, that's something that people who are in solidarity with one another can do. And I think that redistributing of funds and wealth to people in need, whether that's, bailout funds for people who are incarcerated or, protesters who are incarcerated, that is also something that anyone with financial resources can do. So there are things we can do as individuals, but I would say as communities, we need to sort of step up to bridging those conversations, creating platforms for Black people in solidarity to discuss what they
need
from
Asian American communities.
Seems like Warren's back.
Yeah, it seems like Warren's back. Warren, we can hear you. He muted himself, though. Warren, we can hear you now. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
There we go. Okay.
We're so happy to hear you again.
I just changed to my phone.
Okay, wonderful. Did you hear the question?
No, please.
Okay, I will repeat it. And this will be our last question before closing. Before we move to the closing part, how do we as Asian Americans support the movement behind Defund the Police when many in our community pushes back against this due to either privilege, anti-Black racism, or assimilation into white supremacy? And what are some of the Asian American institutions actively doing this?
You know, first of all, let me say that Kai's explanation of solidarity, I think, was really right on. And the issue of being a good ally, whether it's the issue of defunding the police or whatever the issue is, all my experience has told me the folks that I've worked with, that I've locked arms with, that I've marched with, that I've demonstrated with, that I've worked with, all of them have said, get your shit together. You know, don't worry about mine. Get yours together. Then we can be strong allies together. And I think that's what the demand is coming out of the election. I know I'm not speaking directly to the last question, but I want to make this point. All the people who voted, whether it was for Biden, Harris, or for Trump, they're all saying the same thing. Damn it, this is your last chance to make government work. If government isn't going to work for me, then what do I need government for? And I think that's the phase we're moving into. We're moving from slogans and aspirations and what we want to do, why we want to do it, when we want to get it done, to really how to do it. And I think Melina's reference to Prop J is the perfect example. Having an all-woman LA County Board of Supervisors with Prop J now as a tool to reimagine how government's going to really serve the people is a challenge before us. And Kai mentioned back in the day about freedom schools. You know, the breakfast program that the Black Panther Party had, at that time there were no programs, nutritional programs, feeding kids in school that went to school hungry. Then they saw the Black Panthers do it, and then the schools start incorporating it. We got to make government work. All of us activists got to get out there and do work. We got to take what we believe and what we aspire to do and what we want. We have to manifest it in real, actual programs. We have to build communities. We have to build a movement. We have to show people that this is concrete. It's not just words. It's not T-shirt slogans or, back in my day, car bumper stickers. It's about doing. It's about organizing. It's about showing people what people can do. So I think that's the next phase that we're all going into. The next phase is to show people that government works, how to make it work, hold people accountable to make it work, and change things rather than just talking about how bad homelessness is. How are we going to get these people taken care of? I'm a firm believer that you can talk about giving a person a fish if they need it because they're hungry that day. I get it. But I really believe you got to teach people how to fish. You got to teach them how to fish on their own, self-determination, fight and battle for their own well-being. And then collectively, as in solidarity, we can achieve the things that we need to achieve. So in our community, in the Asian Pacific Islander community, the only positive thing I've seen come out of this coronavirus is with this anti-Asian hate that's out there, a lot in our community are realizing that we're not just adjacent white people. We're people onto ourselves. We're dealing with issues. We have to look at how we can work with other communities in partnership and solidarity. We have to reimagine what our communities are going to be like. We have to reimagine and make those ideas and dreams come to fruition in concrete work to improve our lives. So as Kai mentioned about love, Kai mentioned about solidarity, what Melina is doing by changing the course of history. When people read the history books, they're going to look at this point in the history of Black Lives Matter. They're going to look at other points in history that have really altered the direction we're going in. And the direction we're going in has to be together, in unity, in solidarity, toward a community and society that's going to serve the best interest of all. We got to lift all boats. So the issue of defunding the police to me is going to be reimagining how you do law enforcement, criminal justice. But as we get people out of jail, or if we don't put them in jail, are they getting an education? Are they learning how to get a job? I mean, we just had the NBA draft, so we have 50 new multimillionaires, most of which are going to be in the African-American community. Does that change the landscape for the African-American community as a whole? As Dr. Cornel West says, we've had colored faces in high places. Is that what changes things? No, what changes things is a people's movement, Black Lives Matter movements, a solidarity with all people of color, all oppressed people, people working together, working class, so forth and so on. It's an exciting time. The thing I would just end on is people talk about this misused word where they say a Chinese word for crisis is a combination of danger and opportunity. I don't think that's true, but I like the concept. Because as we deal with the dangers during the crisis, great opportunity, opportunity for new ideas, new ways of solving problems, new ways of doing business, new ways of helping people, new ways of making society the kind of society we want for ourselves and for future generations.
Wow, thank you, Warren. I'm glad you were able to come on and share those words with us. We do need to end in a few minutes. So Melina and Kai, I would love to hear from you in a few words. What does the future you dream of look like? Melina?
See, I should have pulled up my vision statement. I think that we are at a moment when the world has cracked wide open, when all of our radical imaginings can come to pass if we're willing to struggle for them and struggle for them. And I love the way Kai talked about the difference between solidarity and allyship, right? In solidarity, you know, if we're willing to struggle for our radical imaginings. My radical imagining is living in a world where people have all of what they need and most of what they want.
Yes.
And we can have that. We just have to make the choice and commit ourselves to it. So we have to remember also that this is the first time, at least in my lifetime, when the world is this wide open. So we can't squander this moment. We have to be unafraid and courageous. We have to not tether ourselves, untether ourselves from old systems that are dying anyway, and latch on to each other and latch on to those imaginings, to those freedom dreams, is something that will come to pass as long as we're willing to usher them in.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. Kai, we'll end with your words.
That was so beautiful. I love the idea that we can make our radical imaginings into realities. Yeah, I would say that my dream of the future is one in which we don't have to struggle for Black lives to be respected and cared for, that is a given, that Black women are protected and their desires met, that queer and in which queer and trans people's lives are protected and their desires met, and in which we, you know, have managed to and learned how to care for and prioritize the health of the planet, because I think that is also, you know, a real danger on our horizon that we don't know necessarily how to approach So that is my dream for the future.
Thank you for that, Kai. I think it's fitting to end on that note with one of the voices leading our next generation of young activists and change makers. A big thanks to our three amazing panelists for your meaningful and memorable engagement in this very important and timely conversation. And to USC Pacific Asia Museum, Chinese American Museum, Japanese American National Museum for organizing and sponsoring this event. This concludes our evening's program. Before exiting the Zoom meeting, feel free to take a couple of minutes to copy down any resources that you saw in the chat or on the resource banner that we will be sharing in a moment. And we do hope all of you who have attended tonight feel inspired to keep engaging in the struggle for liberation on all fronts. We need all of you. We need all of us. We really are stronger together. So stay safe and have a good night.